Hi, I'm Eric Siegel with ericstrains.com. Welcome to episode 24 of my video train blog series. Okay, it's mid-August 2012. I've got a lot of stuff to show you in this episode, so let's go ahead and get started by talking about the upcoming open house for the Piedmont Pilgrimage. The Piedmont Pilgrimage is a tour of Atlanta area layouts that happens every year in the fall. This will be my fourth year on the pilgrimage. My date has been set for Saturday, November 10th. From 1 to 5 p.m. So if you're going to be in the Atlanta area on that weekend, feel free to stop by and check out the layout. For more information, check out their website at www.piedmontpilgrimage.com. Now, as is typical for this time of year, I've just started to do a lot of work on the layout to try to get it as far along as possible before people start showing up for the open house in November. So let's go ahead and take a look at what I've been doing. The first thing I want to show you on the layout is right here. I've just completed my first insert for the layout. What is an insert? An insert is a section of the layout that can be removed to gain access to another section of the layout. There's a tunnel that goes through this hill, and so I need to be able to access the track in the tunnel in case there's a derailment or something like that. And so when I built this hill, I left a big hole right here so that I could gain access to the track. And then the plan was to build an insert that I would put in there to hide the hole, but yet make that hole available if I need it to get into that tunnel. And that's what I've done here. So the insert is right here. The seams are pretty well hidden. They're not 100% invisible, but they're pretty well hidden. And the way it works is that you just pull on this section right here, and it pops right out and gives me access to the tunnel. Pretty cool. And then it goes back in like that. Now, while I was building the insert, I took some photos so that you can see the evolution of its construction. You can see how it started off with just some pink foam to build a frame. Then I put some cardboard lattice and some hard shell foam on top. And then I started to build the scenery, and that's where it's at now. It's looking pretty good. The scenery is not 100% done, of course. I will probably add some more trees and shrubs and stuff to hide the seams a little more as time goes on. But it's looking pretty good, and I'm very happy with it. We're in the main room of the layout now, and on the north side of the main table here, I've done some additional rock and scenery work over the last couple weeks. The rock used to only come up to about right here, but now I've pushed it back another foot or so. And over the next couple months leading up to the Piedmont Pilgrimage, I'd like to push it back even further, hopefully getting all the way down to that back corner. The last thing I want to show you on the layout is here on the south side of the main table, and it's in this big tunnel right here. About 2 feet back or so, there's a switch in the tunnel. And, you know, normally when you design a layout, you try to avoid having switches in tunnels because it makes servicing the switch a real pain in the butt because it's not very accessible. So if the switch is broken for some reason or it needs maintenance, it becomes a hassle to get back there and service the switch. But unfortunately, sometimes you have to do it. On my layout, in order to make the track plan work the way I wanted it to work, I had to have a couple switches be in tunnels, and that's the case with this tunnel right here. Well, a few weeks ago, a train derailed in the tunnel, and it knocked the top off the switch motor housing, which caused the switch to not work correctly. So I had to get in there and service the switch, but unfortunately, since it's way back there, there was no easy way to get in there, so the solution was to come up on the top level of track and cut a new access panel that allows me to get down in there and service that switch. Let me show you. Here we are up on the top level, and here's the hole that I cut with a jigsaw. And if I pop this panel off, there's my access hole to get to that switch underneath. When we look down the hole, you can see there's the switch in the tunnel down below. It's not very big, but it's just large enough to get a hand or two down there so that I can service that switch. Now, of course, right now this panel is very obvious, but eventually I'll cover this with scenery so that in the end, it'll be completely camouflaged. Okay, so that's the work that I've been doing on the layout lately, and over the next couple months leading up to the open house, I'll be doing more and more work, and I'll show you that work as it progresses. And then probably around mid to late October, just before the open house, I'll do a full layout tour video to show you everything on the layout so that you can see where everything's at just before the open house happens. And, you know, that's kind of the direction that I'm moving in. You know, I've come to realize over the last few years that the work on the layout sort of centers around the open house each year, and so rather than making layout videos throughout the year, what I've decided to do is use the blog videos to show you the progress on the layout on a month-to-month basis, and then each year before the pilgrimage, I'll do a big tour video to show you the entire layout, and then that way, you can look at those tour videos from year to year and see the layout progressing from year to year. So it should be pretty neat, and I think that's the way I'm going to do it from now on. Now I'm going to switch gears and talk about something completely different, Lionel post-war trains. Many of you may not know this, but I do have a small collection of Lionel post-war trains from the 1940s and 50s, and even some from the 60s. Most of those post-war trains belonged to my dad when he was a kid back in the 50s, but I've also added some to that collection with stuff that I've bought over the years. Now, generally, I don't run the post-war trains on the layout for a couple reasons. Number one is that the trains on my layout are O-scale, which means they're built to scale, and so the smaller O-27 trains from the 50s would look a little out of place next to the big O-scale trains. But the main reason I don't run the post-war trains on the layout is because the post-war engines are conventionally controlled. They don't have digital command control. And since my layout was built exclusively for command-controlled trains, I can't run those old post-war engines on my layout. I have to run them on a separate loop of track, either under the layout or in the garage or under the Christmas tree or something like that. But I do have them, and it is nice to take those old trains out from time to time because it kind of gets me back to my roots, so to speak. That's where it all started. When I was a kid, I played with my dad's old post-war trains, and so sometimes it's nice to get back to the old simplicity of those post-war trains. Well, a few weeks ago, I was contacted by an old childhood friend who's been watching my YouTube videos and following me on Facebook. And he said, "Hey Eric, you know, I've got a whole bunch of these old post-war trains up in my attic just collecting dust. They used to belong to my dad back in the 50s, and they're just sitting up there doing nothing. And, you know, I'm not interested in selling them or making any money off of them. I just want to give them to someone who will take care of them and actually get them running again and use them." And so I went over to his house and I picked up all those trains and brought them home. And for the past few weeks, I've been working on getting them all cleaned up and getting them in good working order. So let me go ahead and show you what I picked up. The first engine that I want to show you is this Lionel 2025 steam engine. It was made in 1952, so as of 2012, this is a 60-year-old steam engine. The 2025 was not a legendary post-war steam engine. It's not super collectible or anything like that, but it is a nice, solid steam engine, and it's a little bit sentimental for me because my father had a 2025 as well. I've still got my father's old 2025, but it's disassembled right now, and it's not in near as good condition as this one, so it's nice to have a good working 2025 in my collection now. When I first brought the 2025 home, it was not working very well at all, which is typical for an engine that's been up in an attic for many, many years. It was dirty, it was dusty, it was nasty. So I completely disassembled the engine and the tender. I cleaned every single part, and then I reassembled everything. I gave it some new oil and grease, and now it works great. And that's the nice thing about these old post-war trains. Most of the time, if you just give it a good cleaning and some TLC, these things will work just as well as they did when they were brand new. Now, even though this engine is working great, it is missing some parts. It's missing some drive gear here and on the other side, and it's also missing the smoke puffer mechanism on the inside of the engine that allows the smoke to puff out of the smokestack. So I do need to get some replacement parts for this engine. That shouldn't be a big deal. And then I'm going to replace the old smoke unit with a newer smoke unit that will allow it to use smoke fluid instead of those old smoke pills. Appearance-wise, the engine is in pretty good shape for its age. It's got some faded paint and some chips as well, but overall it's in pretty good shape. I will probably eventually touch up these paint chips with some black paint, and then I'll give the engine and the tender a coat of Tester's gloss coat to make them look a little more shiny and a little more new. On the front of the engine, you may notice that the boiler front looks brand new. That's because when I first got the engine, the marker lights were broken off of the front of the boiler, and so I went ahead and replaced this boiler front piece with a brand new reproduction piece. It looks pretty good. Now, just like all post-war engines, this engine is conventionally controlled. That means that it is controlled using the throttle knob on the transformer. But since my layout is designed exclusively for command control systems, such as DCS, Legacy, or TMCC, I cannot run these conventional engines on my layout. The only place I can run these is on a loop of conventional track that I have underneath the layout. But my eventual plan is to retrofit this engine and the other post-war engines that you're about to see with AC Commander boards from the Electric Railroad Company. That will add TMCC to these post-war engines, and then I'll be able to run them up here on the layout, and I'll control them using the Lionel Legacy remote. Another engine that I picked up was a diesel switcher. This is a Lionel 623 Santa Fe NW2 switcher. Lionel made these in the early to mid-50s, so just like the 2025, this is around 60 years old. When I first brought this engine home and put it on the track, it didn't work at all because it was so dirty and nasty on the inside. So I completely disassembled it, I cleaned every single part, reassembled it, re-lubed it, and now it works perfectly. It works just as good as the day it was built back in the 1950s. Externally, the switcher is in pretty decent shape, although it does need some work here and there. It's missing the handrail on the front and on the back. And then at some point, someone got some green spray paint all over this side of the engine. To fix that, I may eventually replace the shell with something that looks a little nicer. And then as far as the frame goes, I may end up just stripping it down and repainting it. So it does need a little bit of work, but overall it's in pretty good shape. And of course, on the inside, everything's working perfectly, which to me is the most important thing. The smallest motorized unit that I picked up was this number 50 section gain car that was built around 1954. When I brought it home, it was really dirty and nasty, and of course it didn't work. I've cleaned it up nicely, and it's just about ready to go, but it does need a couple parts to become operational. The key replacement parts are back here. I need to replace this orange piece of plastic that contains the brush towers, and then I also need to get a new set of motor brushes as well. I'm also going to replace these crew figures up here. This thing originally came with 3 crew figures. 2 are missing, and this one's pretty gnarly. So I'm going to purchase a replacement set for these up here. And then once these are in, and once these parts are replaced back here, this thing should be good to go. Okay, finally we come to the highlight of the post-war engines that I picked up, which is this pair of 2343 Santa Fe F3s. The 2343 is classic. I think that most people would agree that it's the best F3 that Lionel made in the post-war years, and it's certainly one of the most legendary and iconic engines that Lionel ever made. So I was thrilled to find out that my friend's dad's collection featured one of these sets. Now, because this set features the larger GM logo back here, that indicates that this set was probably made around 1950 or 1951. When I first brought this set home, it was really dirty and nasty, and it did not run very well, so just like with the other engines, I completely disassembled this set, I cleaned every single part, reassembled it, and gave it some new oil and grease, and now, mechanically speaking, this set is working perfectly. It's working just as good as the day it was built. On the outside, however, in terms of how this thing looks, that's a different story. From a structural standpoint, this set is in pretty good shape. There's nothing cracked or broken on the outside. But as you can see, there's some pretty bad wear and tear. I think at some point during the time when this engine was in storage, it got laid up against something that was really bad for the paint. And so, especially on this side of both of the engines, the paint is really worn off really badly. So I've got quite a bit of work to do. On the undersides of both of the engines, for the frames, what I'll probably do is just strip the paint off and then use my airbrush to apply a nice new coat of silver paint. On top, though, you know, there's not a whole lot I can do to repair this paint on these shells. So what I may do is try to locate some replacement shells, either some new reproductions or some older shells that are just in better shape. But the overall goal is to get these things looking as good as they're now running. In addition to the engines that you just saw, I also picked up a good assortment of rolling stock, as you can see. Now, I'm not going to go through these items one by one because that would take up too much time, but suffice to say, these are all pretty typical cars. There's nothing really super rare or collectible, but they are nice nonetheless. I've got 3 rows of cars here. This row up here consists of cars that I've already cleaned and fixed up and that are working perfectly. This row here consists of cars that I'm still working on. And then here, I've got a nice set of tin plate passenger cars. Now, these are not working right yet either. I'm still working on them, but once they're up and running, they should be pretty nice. I also picked up a handful of post-war and pre-war accessories, such as the 395 floodlight tower, the 3656 stockyard, the 1045 flagman, the number 45 automatic gateman, and then the 152 crossing signal. They're all in pretty good shape, except for the tower, which is in need of some repair. Last but not least, this is the transformer that came with all those trains that I got. This is a Lionel Type Z 250-watt Trainmaster transformer. These were last made in 1947, so that means that at best, this is 65 years old. And even though it looks a little ratty, it still works. All 4 channels still work. I may at some point open it up and give it a tune-up just to make sure it's working optimally and to make sure that none of the old wiring presents a fire hazard, but the fact that it's still working is just a testament to how well these things were built. Now, since this transformer is still operational, I might as well use it, so I've decided to put it back into service, and I'm going to use it on my layout to power some accessories. So there you have it. As you can see, I picked up some nice post-war gems, and I've been having a lot of fun over the last few weeks getting those trains cleaned up and getting them back into good working order. It kind of takes me back to when I was a kid, because when I was 12 or 13, that's what I would do. I would sit in my basement all day and take apart my dad's old post-war trains. I would take them apart and clean them and rewire them, and that was always really enjoyable, so it's always fun to get back to that. Now, as I said earlier, those old post-war engines are conventionally controlled, and that means that I can't run them on my command-control-equipped layout. But my eventual plan is to add command control to those post-war engines. I'm going to do that by installing what's called an AC Commander Board inside the engines. The AC Commander Board is made by the Electric Railroad Company, and when you install it in the engine, it adds TMCC to the engine. So once I have those installed, I'll be able to run those old post-war engines on my layout using the legacy remote. That should be pretty cool. Now, when I do install one of those boards, I will do a short tutorial video showing how it's done, so keep an eye out for that in the future. Okay, now it's time for the video report. I've got two videos in production right now that are just about ready. The first video is part two of the Atlas track and signal tutorial. I did part one back in May, and part two is just about ready. It should be out really any day now. And then the second video is a review for the Lionel 210-4 Texas steam engine. And then after that, I've got a whole bunch of Lionel engines in the queue waiting to be reviewed. I've got the latest Lionel F7s, a Lionel Shea, a Mikado, a C420 diesel, and then an SD80 diesel, which you can see right behind me here. So there's a whole bunch of videos coming down the pipe. Keep an eye out for all of those in the coming months. And then, of course, as I said earlier, in mid to late October, I'll be doing a full layout tour video. I know a lot of you guys have been looking forward to that. So that'll be out in October, and hopefully you guys will enjoy it. The last thing I want to show you today is right here. This is a Norfolk Southern Heritage SD70 that Lionel put out a few years ago. It's a beautiful engine, and I actually did a review on this engine a few years ago. You can find that review on my YouTube channel. Now, what makes this engine special is that it just returned to service on my layout after being out of commission for nearly 2 years. As many of you probably already know, a couple years ago I had an accident where several engines fell off of a shelf in my basement, and they fell to the floor, and they were all severely damaged. This was one of those engines. The other engines I was able to repair or replace, but 1982 sort of sat in limbo for a long time. When it fell off the shelf, the front of the shell was completely shattered, and the front coupler was also destroyed. The rest of the engine was actually in pretty good working order. Here's the original shell, and as you can see, there's nothing up front because it was completely shattered. So what I needed to do was replace the shell and the front coupler, but I delayed doing that for a long time, mainly because the shell is sort of expensive. It's about $200. So I put it off and put it off, but then finally a month ago, I bit the bullet and ordered the replacement shell and the replacement coupler. I installed the coupler and the shell, so now 1982 is in good working order and it's back in service on the layout. So I'm really happy to see this engine back in service, and I'm really glad it's no longer sitting on the workbench collecting dust. Okay, so that about wraps it up for this episode. I'm Eric Siegel, and I'll see you next time.
Thank you. clear through the junction. Over.
Yes, 192. The track is clear. Over.
I copy that. 1982 out.